Hello, everybody. Hi. Welcome to GraphQL Execution Strategies. I will give you today an overview over how you can actually execute a GraphQL query in different ways and what actually an execution strategy is. My name is Andy Marek. I am reachable at Twitter and GitHub as @AndyMarek. I'm the creator and one of the maintainers currently of GraphQL Java. I also lived in Berlin for a couple of years, but now I work and live in Sydney, so it was quite a long trip to come here, and I'm really happy to finally give you this talk. So what are we going to do today? First, I will talk a little bit about a result tree. This is kind of needed to talk in a better, clear way about the other stuff that follows. Then we will talk about the default execution strategy. This is basically what is implemented in every GraphQL server. This is what's specified by the spec. Then we will look at the N+1 problem and how data loader helps you to solve this problem. And then finally, we will step outside of the known things, I would say, and look at alternative strategies, particularly at a batching strategy, which helps you to solve the N+1 problem in a different way. And also, we will look at a delegation strategy, which actually is very related to the talk you saw before. This deals with schema composition again. So let's start by, give me a second. Let's start by talking about the result tree. So this is our example schema we will use throughout the whole talk. So nothing fancy. It's a movies. Every movie has a title and a list of directors, and every director has a name. So let's query this schema. And let's assume we're getting back two movies, Avengers Endgame and Lost in Translation, directed by the Russo brothers and Sofia Coppola. So what you see on the right is how you normally look at the GraphQL result. The spec actually describes this not in terms of JSON, but in terms of a map, which maps one-to-one into JSON. But still, it's described as a map. What we want to do today is describe the result of a GraphQL execution as a tree, which means we model this JSON document as a tree. And every node inside this tree has a unique path. This is exactly the same path you can find in a GraphQL error, hopefully. The leaf nodes of this graph, of this tree, have an extra value, which is a scalar, enum, or null. So this sounds all very theoretical. So let's have a look at our example again. And this is how we look at our result now. This is a tree made of a top-level field movies, then four subfields for each of the movie. We have a title and directors for the two movies. And then we have the directors at the bottom. And every leaf node has an additional value, which you already saw in the JSON representation of it. OK, so what is an execution strategy? For this talk, an execution strategy is something that transforms a query into this result tree. This is a very broad, not very accurate description, but good enough for us today. OK, so how does GraphQL now work normally? The default execution strategy is something I would describe as parallel in depth. And this means every field of a query has actually a resolver assigned to it. I think probably all of you, or almost all, are familiar with this concept. You need to define a resolver, which takes care of getting the data for a field. Like in real-life applications, most resolvers are what I would say is trivial, which means they just take the property with the field name from the source object. The source object is what is returned by the parent field. And every resolver is potentially asynchronous. This ties a little bit into what Dan mentioned yesterday. It's you need to be able, or the execution strategy need to be able to deal with every resolver being asynchronous. And This is how the default execution strategy works. Every resolver is called as soon as possible in parallel. So it's really like a local optimized way of executing the query. Again, very theoretical. Let's have a look at our example query and how this works. So we start first. We start with the top-level query, top-level field movies. The resolver is called. The resolver is asynchronous, and you see the dotted lines around it, which means the resolver started, but is not finished yet. So next step. The resolver is finished, and we start immediately resolving all four child nodes. This is what I mean, like as soon as possible in parallel, all four child nodes starting to resolve at the same time. And now the order is kind of made up for this example. So we assume here that the titled node for the second movie is resolved first, and now we have a leaf value, it's lost in translation. And now we assume the directors for the first movie is resolved. And again, we see how the children of this node are starting to resolve immediately again. So very local, optimized to start as soon as possible. And this continues. We get Avengers Endgame, we get the Russo process, we get the next director's node, and then finally we have Sofia Coppola. And again, this is the same tree you saw before, and this is the end of this execution. Okay, so this is all great, but what are the problems you face in real-life projects? And the most prominent problem, I would say, is really the problem of too much queries. This is what is called N plus one problem. And in our example, this means let's assume we need to make one query to get all movies, and let's assume we are getting 100 movies back. And a naive implementation would require to make for every movie a new call to get the directors. So we have one query for the movies and n queries for the directors. This is the n plus one problem. So as you can see, with 100 movies, you already get 100 directors queries, and this doesn't scale. So normally, you need to do something about it. This is where Data Loader comes into the picture. Data Loader is based on an internal tool by Facebook. It's released alongside GraphQL.js, and there's a great video by Lee outside, out there on YouTube where you can dive into the details. The fundamental idea here is it adds an additional layer to your execution strategy in terms of the strategy is not changed at all, but what you do inside the resolver is changed. So the resolver doesn't call the database, the other service, whatever, directly. It delegates to Data Loader. And the Data Loader now takes care of batching a couple of requests together and then calls you again, and you can resolve, for example, in our case, n directors at the same time. So you don't make 101 queries for 100 movies, you make two queries. One to get the movies and one to get the directors. The JavaScript implementation does this by batching everything together, which runs in one event loop execution, in one frame of execution. Ports of Data Loader actually exist for a couple of other languages. And it's a really interesting design, actually, but it relies fundamentally on having some kind of synchronization point. If you collect all the requests, you need to dispatch them. You need to say, okay, now we are finished collecting, please start loading the actual data. So without having this kind of synchronization point, you need to do something else. For example, in GraphQL Java, we have a data loader also, but our way of tracking our synchronization point is much more complex than the JavaScript implementation because we don't have an event loop in Java. So again, coming back to our example, how does a data loader implementation for this query looks? The execution strategy doesn't change at all, so we pause it at this point where we want to get the directors for the two movies. And what happens here is you delegate to data loader, and data loader calls your red box. This is your custom loading code with give me please the directors for this for these two movies. So now you can make one call and you give it back to data loader. Data loader kind of feeds it back to the resolvers, and you get the same tree as before, and you're happy, and you kind of solved the n plus one problem for this query. Okay. This is all great, but there's another way how to attack this problem, and this is where we leave the known specified area a little bit. And how can we do this, or why can we do this? This is probably the most underrated sentence in the whole GraphQL specification, in my opinion. This gives you kind of a loophole out of it. It tells you you can do everything or anything you want as long as the perceived result is equivalent. So as long as the user doesn't know what you're doing, you can implement your GraphQL server, your execution strategy in any way possible. As again, as long as the perceived result is equivalent. So we are using now this loophole and going to a new execution strategy, which is based on the idea of creating n nodes at the same time. So really, we for the first time, we kind of leaving our local optimized idea and zooming out a little bit and looking at the whole result tree at once and see, we want to create two nodes. Okay, let's call a batch resolver, which takes n source inputs at the same time and not only one, and which returns n results. So this is batching on a strategy level, which means you don't need data loader. It's solved on a higher level if you want to. So batching strategy itself is really interesting, honestly, and it's not really explored yet. And there's not one batching strategy. Like, you can imagine different ways of how you want to select the nodes you want to create at the same time. But we will go here with the simplest version. We decide we want to create these nodes together, which come from the same query field. So let's have a look at our example again. This looks very familiar, hopefully, until now. And you see, we want to create the two directors nodes. And instead of delegating to data loader, this red box of you, your custom loading code gets fed the two source inputs, like the two movies at the same time. And then you can make one call and you return the two directors or the list for the two movies, in this case, three directors. So this is like your custom loading code doesn't really change at all, but the strategy kind of knows that you want to batch and calls you directly. Okay, a couple of notes about this. This really means node creation is coupled together. So nothing comes without a cost. It's a trade-off. Like before, in the default execution, every node was resolved as soon as possible, and now you kind of force nodes together. Like, and this means there are cases, you can construct some cases where batching strategy is actually slower than the default one. So I would say normally it is not the case, but there are theoretical cases where the batching version is slower. One important note also, data loader actually does two things. Data loader gives you batching, and it also gives you caching. And a normal strategy is not concerned with caching at all. You kind of need to take care of it yourself, or you need to extend the strategy maybe. But what I describe here today has nothing to do with caching, and data loader actually helps you also to have some cache. So I would say, under the assumption that you have ways to deal with the n plus one problem in your domain, the batching strategy is probably the more suitable version. And this is implemented in GraphQL Java. We actually have two versions of it because of historical reasons, but it's not implemented, as far as I know, in other languages. Please correct me after the talk if I'm wrong. And so if somebody wants to give it a shot in GraphQL.js, maybe feel free. Okay. This was our second strategy. Now we are looking at a different kind of beast. We are looking at a delegation strategy. And why you want this, it is the same area Mark touched yesterday and now with the Apollo Federation previous, like in the previous talk. It's all about schema composition again. So this strategy helps you to implement a GraphQL gateway where you want to actually have a little bit logic maybe in your gateway, but the actual GraphQL execution should be handled in the underlying services. So this is where the name delegation comes from. You kind of transform the query maybe a little bit or cut something off or so, but fundamentally you delegate the execution to an underlying service, and then you need to kind of deal with this and bring it together and give back to the client a valid answer. So this is why delegation strategy. And instead of describing this in a theoretical way, and this is not very nice, honestly, to describe in a theoretical way, we will directly dive into our example. So now let's assume you have a lot of movies and you have a lot of directors and you have two teams or at least two different services. One deals with movies, one deals with directors. So you have a movies schema for the movie service, which just has movies, and every movie has a title, and the movie has a list of director IDs. This is kind of a foreign key, which feeds into the director service, and the director service has a give me all directors with this ID field, and every director has an ID and name. So what we want to do here is we want to take the director's IDs, feed it into the movies, into the director service, and hydrating basically a new value out of it. So what does it mean? What do we have to do in order to make this happen? We get the movies from the movie service. So good so far? So good? Read the directors from the movies, for the movies from the response. Then we feed the director IDs into the director service. And then we want to combine these two result trees to get one overall result. So this is our result from the first call to the movie service. And you already see this is kind of a different tree here. You have a movies top level node, and you have four leaves, and the leaves actually have like the director IDs in it. So you don't have a full director object. This is in another service. Then we take these three IDs, D1, D2, D3, feed it into the director service and getting back another tree, which has three leaves in it with the three director names. And this means we have these two result trees now. And what we need to do is we need to move the leaf nodes up and combine both trees together. This is not really perfect yet. If you look a little bit closer, you can see that the path is not right and suddenly some inner node has some values. So we need to kind of fix this, and we get again the same result tree for the overall query we saw before in the other examples. Okay. This is, I really want to stretch this. This is really going outside of the concept of resolver or coercion. There's nothing like this. This execution strategy doesn't have resolver, it doesn't have coercion for resolver. It's really, it deals with result trees and how to combine them together. It's, it takes like an approach of looking at the whole query at the same time, instead of the very local focus aspect of the default strategy. And result trees are first-class citizen. So you may want to maybe validate the result from an underlying service, but fundamentally you take this, you trust this underlying service that the query was executed correctly, and you combine it as we saw. Sorry. It's overall quite different from the default version and the batched version. The batched version really zoomed out a little bit already and saw multiple nodes you want to create together at the same time, but it still has resolvers. It still has some resemblance to the original strategy, but this one doesn't have anything like this. And it's not a theoretical thing here. It's actually implemented in a project called Nadel. This is not really ready yet, but this is already everything implemented, and you can look at the repository. This is already open source. Okay, so this is all great, but what if I told you this is just the beginning? We really stepped outside of what the spec tells you how a query should be executed and looked at different ways how to achieve it. So this is alternative execution strategies are not really explored at all. Like, there's not even a real definition of what an execution strategy is. We use this loophole from the specification to allow us to do other things, but the spec doesn't really describe, for example, what is really a perceived result or what not. The whole specification deals with how to implement the default strategy. So maybe, hopefully in the future, we will see some kind of modification maybe to the spec, which makes kind of this perceived resolve more clear compared to one example how to implement it. Ideas of different strategies could, for example, include intelligent versions, where you kind of look at the results of the previous queries and see, whoa, this was very, very slow. This service doesn't deal with this kind of queries in a good way. Let's try to optimize it that this service gets the query first, for example. Or maybe, this service is good in getting 10 queries or 100, but not good with 1,000. So we need to kind of deal with this. So I could imagine that we have some of the intelligent strategies based really on previous results. One really interesting topic is modeling an explicit dependency graph. In GraphQL, you have really this implicit notion of one field needs to get the parent field result, like resolver value, fed into itself. So you have this implicit dependency tree which says one field needs to be executed before the children can be executed. And if you model this dependency graph explicitly instead of implicitly, there are ways to maybe optimize it and say, this field doesn't really need to wait. You can actually execute it further. Yeah, this was an overview over the different execution strategies which are actually implemented as far as I know and how this relates to the specification. Thank you very much.